Hello, greetings and welcome. Alexander Azadgan here, Professor of Strategic Global Management and International Political Economy, as well as Editor-at-Large with United World International. If you haven't visited our site, uwidata.com, please do so. We have some excellent articles there. I'm an editor there, and we're doing some wonderful work over there. Please visit our website and read our articles there. uwidata.com. We just came off of international air on a story that was quite interesting. So we are recording this extra feature for you, an extensive one, hopefully, I don't know, around half an hour. Please be patient with us. If you haven't subscribed to our YouTube channel, please do so to get regular updates. Soon we are going to have 900 videos of my TV interviews, radio interviews, newspaper interviews, my lectures, these kind of post-interview analyses, and my lectures at the universities and think tanks. Support us, subscribe to us, and we are providing a lot of value here. The story was that Iranian President Rouhani, was quite upset and warning his counterparts in Washington that once again Washington is allowing its terrorists, ISIS or IS or ISIL, whatever you want to call them, they're a bunch of terrorist savages with methods that go back to really the Middle Ages, cutting heads and what have you. They're almost being defeated in Syria, these savages. The last front is Idlib, the city of Idlib in northern Syria. And the Russians, the Iranians, and the Lebanese Hezbollah, along with the Syrian Arab army, have been making some excellent progress in defeating these savages, who are our terrorists, by the way. We have supported them logistically. The Turks, who were on the wrong side, supported them logistically. Saudi Arabia, Qatar, UAE, and a host of other countries, including Israel, have been supporting these people to create instability and chaos in Syria, because Israelis and people in Washington, the hawks in Washington, believe if they destroy Syria, they're going to cut off a bridge between Iraq and Iran and Lebanese Hezbollah, the so-called axis of resistance, to stand up to Israel. And the Israelis have been emboldened since Donald Trump got into office, a clear and present danger to American interests. I'm talking about Donald Trump. In recognizing the moving of the American embassy to Jerusalem, in recognizing that Jerusalem, Al-Quds, should be the capital of Israel, completely against international law, and the UN declared a very strong veto on that several months ago in not accepting that, in condemning this. Mr. Trump has emboldened the Israelis. He's completely biased towards them, to the point that the occupied Golan Heights, which belong to Syria, the Israelis occupied them after the 1967 war, and now they're officially annexed as part of their own territory. They are increasing the level of Mr. Trump, President Trump, to a point where the Israelis, and most people don't know this, the Israelis have actually created coins of gold and silver with the picture of Trump, like a side profile face of Trump, next to the great Iranian king Cyrus the Great, comparing Mr. Trump, a novice, an anarchist, if you want to go into that, and compare them to this Iranian king Cyrus, which the Israelis believe was the greatest liberator of the Zionist Jews. And the Zionism really goes back to the time of Dathan, this character who lived around the same time as Moses, who was tricking him and his followers, were tricking the Israelites after they've been liberated from Egypt. And Dathan, this character, was a collaborator with the Egyptian masters of the poor Jewish people in Egypt. And even after the liberation of Israelites from Egypt, he came with them, right? He actually exited with them. He came along with the Israelites, but he was always trying to tempt the Israelis, or shall we say the Jews, the Israelites, into going the wrong path, shall we say, with all sorts of pagan things, all sorts of behavior against the law of Moses, the worshiping of the calf, all that. So when I say and we believe that he was the first Zionist, because the Zionist Jews, if you may, want to leave God out of the equation, and they want to be just nationalist and sort of like a Jewish patriots. We also saw this type of mentality with the Zealots 2,000 years ago, who were rebelling against the Roman Empire. They were not; they were political hustlers. They were not religious Jews. They were not law-abiding Jews. They were just anarchists, and they all committed mass suicide after the Roman general Titus, who became an emperor several years after that. They committed suicide at a place called Masada. It's the very interesting fort on top of a hill, very strategically located. When the Romans finally got to them, they all committed suicide, which is strictly against the Mosaic and Judaic law. At any rate, the secular Israelis are exactly that. They are sort of the leftovers of the mentality of this character, Dathan, which we believe was the first Zionist in history. At least we have records of that. Another thing I mentioned on international air, Israel is being emboldened by the behavior and the carte blanche and the green light that Mr. Trump has been extending to them. We don't believe this policy will change. We are forecasting, my colleagues and I are forecasting that Mr. Trump is going to be unfortunately reelected based on what we are seeing with these people in the Democratic Party. It's an absolute disaster. The Democrats, unfortunately, have become experts in nominating losers. And if this trend goes on, they're probably going to nominate the Vice President Joe Biden. And if they were to nominate, and I'm not a fan of Bernie Sanders, but if he was to be nominated, and all polls indicate that he's the only one who can defeat Mr. Trump. It's unfortunately not going to happen. There's so many angles to that. He's a socialist. There's so much fear mongering when it comes to that term, even though we have so many models of socialism. The VA is a model of socialism, veteran administration, the post office, all our public libraries, Medicare. We have so many examples of socialism, but this term has been turned into some fear-mongering term amongst those who are illiterate in this country. Unfortunately, he's not going to be, I shouldn't say unfortunately, because I'm not a pro-Sanders fan, but this country is at the core of this country, we have this pure racism, and in my assessment, they're never going to nominate a person of Jewish heritage. Part of the reason Al Gore lost is when he chose Lieberman, Senator Lieberman at that time from Connecticut, as his vice president. So this country is never going to allow a vice president, or definitely a president of who has the background of Jewish ethnicity to be elected. This is a sad reality. Even if he's a anti-Zionist, the progressive, liberal like Bernie Sanders. My whole point is that Mr. Trump is going to get reelected. That's our forecast, because there's really nobody formidable that's going to be nominated by the Democrats. I like some of the things that I'm hearing from the senator from Massachusetts. Her name doesn't come into my mind, but she's a former professor at Harvard, and she came into office during a time that we had a financial crisis here, and she was excellent in trying to hold the feet of a lot of these banks, hold their feet to fire, although they were not necessarily successful. I think if she gets nominated, it would be wonderful. She should have really got nominated in 2016. She would have been a formidable candidate. We would have been proud to have a female president like her instead of somebody grotesque as Hillary Clinton. But unfortunately, the politics are so corrupted here in the United States that there seems to be seniority who gets into office instead of the character of the nominee, the character of the people that are running. It's absolute corrupt. It's like a monarchy system. People are lined up for power. I can't recall her name. The senator from Massachusetts. I believe she's a senior senator from Massachusetts. After the death of Ted Kennedy, At any rate, Israelis are emboldened. They're going to continue to be emboldened. The second term of Mr. Trump, I'm not an alarmist in my work, dear viewers, but I believe the second term of Mr. Trump, we could possibly have a limited conflict between Israel and Iran. The Saudis and the Emiratis wouldn't dare attack Iran because Iran has made it very obvious that it's going to defend itself. The news item that's taking place right now is that a Saudi oil installation, which apparently processes half of the Saudi oil, was attacked by Ansarullah, the Yemeni Ansarullah. And this is very, very important. The correct term, you know, they use this term, Houthi rebels. That's their term. This is the term that's used by Yemen's enemies. The correct term is Ansarullah fighters or Ansarullah forces. And these people are backed up by the armed forces of Yemen. Yes, they are Shiite. Yes, they're getting supported by Iran. And who knows what level of support they're getting, but they actually attacked a very the important oil facility of Saudi Arabia. So Iran is sending very strong signals to Saudi Arabia of their potential power by supporting the Ansarullah forces or fighters. And this is a very risky game the Iranians are engaged in. They're just trying to project power and say, look, we can, with our missiles, we can reach anywhere. And as a matter of fact, one of the highest ranked IRGC generals was on record in the past couple of days saying that if Iran gets attacked, this is how they're going to react. And he actually invoked attacking a U.S. battleship and two or three major U.S. bases in the Persian Gulf. So this is if Trump is in office and he stays in office and the Israelis keep getting emboldened, the Saudis keep getting emboldened, the so-called crown prince in Saudi Arabia, Mohammed bin Salman, which is quite possible he may become the king in the next few years to come, quite possibly in the second term of Mr. Trump. This is a very aggressive and unexperienced novice. And the Israelis are trying to create this narrative of Iran versus Saudi Arabia. I call it the Iran-Iraq War 2.0, version 2.0. They're trying to get two very strong Muslim countries to attack each other, and the price of oil is going to skyrocket. And who's going to benefit from that? United States. We are going to benefit from that. The extra regional powers like us, the Russians, definitely, another huge benefactors of high oil prices, while there will be a proxy war in the Persian Gulf. Yes, the price of oil is going to be, excuse me, rather high, but when you're engaged in a war, it's not going to benefit you much because you're going to have a hard time exporting your oil. The Iranians have a capacity of around 3 million barrels a day of exporting their oil. That's how much, after JCPOA, in the very beginning of the Rouhani administration, they were exporting around 2.7 million barrels of oil per day, almost reaching the capacity. Now they're at 800,000 barrels per day, which is a disaster for them. It's reducing their income drastically, the government budget. And there are talks that they're selling their oil well below market prices offshore in the middle of the ocean off of their oil tanks. There was an incident of an Iranian oil tank parked close to the Chinese port of Dalian, and they were using this to store the Iranian oil in the huge Chinese oil containers, those circular, like the cylinder type tanks. And there's another story that the Chinese are not exactly true allies to the Iranians, are exploiting the Iranians by waiting to see how desperate Iran gets to buy the oil at a cheaper price. This is what I've always consulted our Iranian counterparts, that you cannot count on any superpower. China and U.S.'s bilateral trade volume is huge. It's over $500 billion dollars per year. I think it's, to be exact, I think it's around $660 billion per year, the two-way trade between the U.S. and China. They're never going to sacrifice that for Iran or for any other country. They will use Iran as a leverage against the Chinese. I'm talking about Trump when it comes to trade negotiations, which is actually a trade war. The Russians are going to use Venezuela as a leverage in order to get more concessions from Venezuela. And same with Russia and Iran. Russians are going to use Iran as a leverage to get more concessions from the Iranians. Same with the Chinese. So they really cannot count on any big power. They have to become indigenous in every which way. And if the contemporary history of Iran has proved anything, is when they're under tremendous amount of pressure, economic and political, militarily, when they rely on their own domestic capacity for all those factors that I just named, they actually thrive under chaos. This was the case during the Iran-Iraq war. This was the case after their war with Iraq ended with their missile technology, which is 100% indigenous. So this is what they need to go back to. But there's so much internal problems, economic corruption within Iran, that this is becoming difficult to implement. Their head of the judiciary, Mr. Raisi, he's going after he's smart. He's starting with the small fish and he's going after the big fish. And we have a lot of hope that he may be able to clean house within the internal political economic situation in Iran. Something else I mentioned on live air was that everybody should read this book called The Ugly American. I'll hold it up here for you. I have a copy in my library, written by William Lederer and Eugene Burdick. This was written in the 1950s. This particular one, the copyright is from 1958. And in order to understand the attitude of Washington, I don't like the term ugly American because it's too insulting to all of us Americans. We are very anti-war country, believe it or not. We have no say in the behavior of our politicians in Washington, especially the hawks. But Americans, in our history, we've been involved in something around 243 years of 255 years, something around that figure, of our existence. So we've been involved in so many wars, some of them for defensive purposes. The Revolutionary Wars fall under that. That was obviously defensive. It was a noble war because we wanted to have our independence from Britain. But all the other wars we're engaged in, it's just absolutely crazy. So it's ingrained into the minds and hearts of Americans to continue to have this concept of perpetual war, non-stop wars, you know, something like what the Europeans were engaged in their 100-year war, right, between France and England at that time, or the internal war between various factions in England, the War of the Roses, right, the whites against the reds. This is what the neocons want to implement, an ongoing war, intervention everywhere around the world where our so-called national interests are at stake. And we're bankrupting ourselves with that kind of mentality. But it's not as simple as that. You have the Chinese with their Belt and Road Initiative, really just connecting themselves with Europe via land through Eurasia. And then we are in a very tough place. We are a corroding empire. And if the petrodollar system is ever under threat, World War III will begin, I can guarantee you. And World War III, in a way, has already began economically. All wars start economically. As the German general, the strategist, von Clausewitz, put it so precisely, he said war is an extension by politics, by other means. So if politics fail, if political negotiations fail, then the war is an extension of that. I add to that quotation, this very interesting quotation, by saying that politics is an extension of economics by other means. And geopolitics and geoeconomics go hand in hand, are 100% intertwined. So you got to read this book. Again, it's an old book before Vietnam. And it just describes the attitude that we have had going back to the 1950s when we had the Cold War. And again, this was before our atrocities in Vietnam, a war that was one of the most horrible wars in our history. Most American students know how many soldiers were lost. Around 58,000 American soldiers lost their life. But a few of them know, I'm talking K-12 level, a few of the students from the K through 12 level know that we killed around 300,000 Vietnamese civilian and military personnel combined. Most students don't know that until they get to the college level and the graduate level, graduate school level, to understand the atrocities we committed. And this book came before that, before our engagement in Vietnam. So this is a must read in some of my classes. Again, it's by William Lederer and Eugene Burdick. Why am I mentioning this right now in this analysis? It's because the modus operandi of Washington is exactly that, what they wrote in this book. The Washington is becoming a unilateralist wrecking ball since 9/11, right? Since our invasion and occupation of Afghanistan, followed 2 years later in 2003 by our invasion and occupation of Iraq, getting rid of a secular dictator, and having fueling sectarianism, religious sectarianism between the Sunnis and the Shias, and then you add the Kurdish element, you add the Yazidi Christian element, you add all these, because Iraq is a very multicultural, multi-ethnic country. I would say second after Iran, and then creating such chaos and anarchy in Iraq that is absolutely mind-boggling. This is an example of a unilateralist wrecking ball, because nobody's standing up to us. There is no multipolar world, at least for the time being. That will be the arrangement if you don't have World War III in the next decades to come, with China, Russia, and India entering this sphere of influence, influencing in the Middle East. But for the time being, it's absolutely crazy. And the people, our excuse to go to Afghanistan in 2001, a country that has had been war ravished for many years, 20 years before 2001, with what the Soviets did in that country since the early 1980s, and then the complete destruction of infrastructure in Afghanistan at the hands of the Soviets, who, in my opinion, were lured to come into that war because the policy from Washington was to bankrupt Soviet Union. And what other way to bankrupt the country than getting them stuck in a non-ending war? The Soviets lost in that war because we supported the so-called Mujahideen and all these other groups. Osama bin Laden was involved in that war. And they left. They put their tails between their legs and they left, the Soviets. And a few years later, they collapsed. The Soviet Union collapsed because they financially bankrupted themselves in Afghanistan, and as well as all sorts of internal economic problems. Why am I mentioning this thing? Why am I invoking Afghanistan? It's our justification to go into that country was to get rid of Taliban, because Taliban was supporting Osama bin Laden and hosting him. And 18 years later, since 2001, right? Since, I would say, when did we invade that country? Around December or November, something around that time frame in 2001, using 9/11 as a pretext. 18 years later, not too long ago, Trump wanted to sit down with these people, with these terrorists, the Taliban terrorists, using just as horrific of methods as ISIS, and they want to negotiate at Camp David with these people. So this is a horribly failed foreign policy. 18 years later, trillions of dollars wasted, countless of American soldiers dying, God knows how many Afghanis died, and this is the first war in our history that more soldiers are dying after the wars when they come back home. 20 veterans kill themselves a day, those who come from Afghanistan and Iraq. The situation is different in Syria because we have special forces operatives there. Illegal U.S. bases in this country. They were never invited. I told Press TV a few minutes ago that the Russians were invited by the legitimate government of that country, regardless of how you feel about Bashar al-Assad, the president of Syria. Regardless of how you feel about him, he is the UN-recognized president of Syria. And as the president, as the head of the government in Syria, at a time of national crisis, he can ask anyone to come into the aid of that country. He asked the Iranians to come in, the special attaches and advisors, followed by Iranian special forces who came to Syria to help the Syrian Arab army, right? The legitimate army of Syria. The Russians came in the August and September of 2015. I remember I was in Iran at that time on an academic mission. And then they asked for the help of the Lebanese Hezbollah, right? This is, and most people don't understand. The Western media would never tell you this. The mainstream fake news would never tell you that Iran and Syria had a mutual defense pact, which means if either country is attacked, it's the responsibility of the other country to come to its aid militarily. This was completely legal from that perspective. Countries have mutual military pacts with each other to increase their leverage, to be able to defend themselves. So the presence of the Iranian advisors and attaché, this is what this was the vocabulary in the beginning of this war. It was actually the Iranian special forces there, okay? IRGC forces there. The no-head force within the Iranian army, the special commandos, the Green Beret. They were all there, okay? But the Iranians didn't want to talk about it much because the way NATO and Washington were so adamant about Iranians not having a presence there, and that the fact that they could use that as a reason to impose more sanctions against Iran after the Iranian nuclear deal. The Iranians didn't publicize it much, but we all saw how Trump took the United States out of the JCPOA, the Iranian nuclear deal, and using anything and everything as an excuse to, having come out of that treaty, some people say it was not a treaty, it was just a mutual understanding between Iran and US, whatever you want to call it, they would use anything as an excuse to impose more sanctions, as they have under the Trump administration, to violate the letter and the spirit of the Iranian nuclear deal. They didn't want to give any excuses to Washington by calling it the presence of Iranian special forces there. So just call it, they just call it the military attaches and advisors. Why they're so petrified of Iran? This is something we mentioned on air. Noam Chomsky, our wonderful colleague, Professor Emeritus at MIT, has just put it, he just put it in one sentence that just sums it up. He said, quotation, Iran has to be punished because it broke free from Washington control in Iran in their 1979 revolution. That's it, unquote. That's exactly it. The reason they're petrified of Iran is that Iran has a very strong missile deterrent capability. If they're attacked, they will retaliate, okay? And the, another reason they're so petrified of Iran is because Iran is regionally and geopolitically is gaining momentum. After victories in Syria, and for most part, we got defeated. Washington got defeated in Syria, more or less. President Trump wanted to bring out our 2,000 special forces there. There was a lot of strong talk about that. And I'll go into that in context of the John Bolton? Doesn't matter. I'm having a brain freeze. After the Iranian victory in Syria, in Iraq, and soon in Yemen, Iran is now battle strengthened like no other time in their immediate contemporary history. Washington and its European allies, the transatlantic alliance, doesn't want that. They want to stop this momentum. And this is exactly what is going on. Now, just John Bolton, actually. The firing of John Bolton by President Trump, we were all very impressed with that. I'm a very strong critic of Mr. Trump, both the way he conducts himself in internal U.S. politics, his clear racism, it's just unpardonable. People talk about impeaching him. I think we should invoke the 25th Amendment, that this man is incapacitated. He's mentally ill. right? He cannot perform the offices, the duties of the office correctly because he's got problems, mental problems. Having said all that, the firing of John Bolton, we were all impressed, my colleagues and I. Hopefully, Mike Pompeo would be next, right? The U.S. Secretary of State. John Bolton was the National Security Advisor. The two most important roles, in my opinion, and I was taught by my own professors, when it comes to the any presidential administration, are from a geopolitical perspective, from a foreign policy perspective, international relations perspective, is the NSA, National Security Advisor, and the Secretary of State. Both of these people are hawks. Mike Pompeo is an absolute disgrace. He's an Iranophobe. He's a disgrace to the U.S. Officers' cadet school, right? West Point. He's a West Point graduate. He's a disgrace to that institution, which is contains many men and women of honor. We cannot paint the whole thing with the same brush, with one brush. He's a disgrace to that. And he's our Secretary of State. He has a clear record of Iranophobia and interventionism in the Middle East, and especially in Iran. And hopefully he'll be fired next. Now, we don't know who's going to be brought into that administration. The fact that John Bolton was brought into this administration was a clear influence from the neocons, sort of tightening the noose around President Trump and controlling him and trying to take away his independent approach when it comes to foreign policy. And let's not forget that President Trump looked into the eyes of Hillary Clinton in one of the debates and said, your policy, Mrs. Clinton, Secretary Clinton, as a Secretary of State, and President Trump, Obama, cost United States $6 trillion. And we had nothing to show for it, except incurring more and more debt, and we have been defeated. We've been defeated in Iraq, we've been defeated in Syria, and all other areas in the world, soon Yemen. And Mr. Trump, when we all heard that, we were very much impressed that Mr. Trump is sort of carrying the mantle of the libertarians within the Republican Party. But he doesn't have, even though he has a very strong will and he wants to be independent, some of these old criminals from Bush Jr. administrations came in to this administration, and the old guard were fired. Rex Tillerson, the Secretary of State, more or less left and was fired. Stephen Bannon, an economic nationalist who doesn't believe in American intervention all around the world, had to resign. A lot of these people, General Flynn, who wanted to have a better relation between U.S. and Russia, was fired. So many of the old guard were fired, and they were replaced by these neocons. And the one that's still left in that administration is Mike Pompeo. Hopefully he'll be fired next. I think President Trump wants to be seen as a deal maker, especially with Iran. He tried to attempt it with North Korea. Of course, the North Koreans, and as well as Iranians, are much smarter. This man wants to score in points from an international relations perspective as well as domestic political perspective. And none of those countries want to hand those victories to him. The Iranians are desperate. You have these neoliberals in Tehran in the executive branch. So they are looked upon very suspiciously by the conservatives within Iran. You don't have that same situation in North Korea. They have more or less a more homogeneous foreign policy. The Iranians have a lot of infighting between various faction and ideologies, and we can really divide that between the conservative and the liberal camp. And the man who's in charge of the executive branch, President Rouhani, is clearly a liberal, and he thinks he can negotiate everything. But I think after the Iranian nuclear deal and that disastrous deal for the Iranians, I think they are very much contained now. They don't have their own willpower, and I think the IRGC is conducting its own foreign policy in Iran in conjunction with the office of their supreme leader. This is so interesting. I have to mention this thing because these things are all intertwined. When Bashar al-Assad came to Iran, and it was done at the behest of the IRGC and General Qasem Soleimani, and the foreign minister was not informed of this foreign state visit, he resigned for a few days. Dr. Zarif, the foreign minister, was very upset that he wasn't informed Bashar al-Assad visiting Iran and more or less, you know, declaring victory in Tehran for the war in Syria. And we have to be careful. It wasn't necessarily a Syrian civil war. Yes, it had that factor in the early in 2011 when this whole mess started. But you had these savages that were gathered from all around the world, became known as ISIS, and they were supported by regional powers like Saudi Arabia and Qatar and Turkey and Israel and Jordan and UAE, United Arab Emirates, as well as NATO, Washington being part of it. So my whole point is that when Bashar al-Assad visited Tehran, hugged the Iranian supreme leader, and it was a very jovial moment for both of these leaders because they more or less defeated the terrorists in Syria. The Iranian foreign minister resigned for a few days, and his resignation was not accepted by President Rouhani of Iran, and he came back on board. So my point is that they don't have full power in wanting to negotiate with Mr. Trump. And Mr. Trump wants to be seen as a deal maker. This is how he came into office. All he cares about is business, right? Let's just make deals. You know, he has no understanding of the complexity, the geoeconomic and geopolitical complexity of things around the world in international arena. And he thinks he can conduct himself the way he was making deal with everybody, you know, for his golf courses and his properties. A New York hustler, real estate hustler that he is, and then a media personality. But underneath it all, you know, in the choices that we have, Trump wants to be seen as a deal maker, not as a warmonger. That's why, you know, John Bolton was fired. And if Mr. Pompeo's rhetoric doesn't stop, and he's been very toxic in his rhetoric against Iran especially, he's going to be next, hopefully. He's going to be the next person to go. We don't know who's the two people. We don't know who's going to be our new NSA. We don't know that. And if Pompeo's fired, we don't know who's going to be the next Secretary of State. It's very hard to speculate on these issues because the neocons are not going to give up in this administration. They are the backbone of the hawk element of the Republican Party. So he doesn't want to be seen as a warmonger, President Trump. He wants to make a deal with everybody. He thinks he can make a new deal with the Iranians. And the Iranians, in spite of the horrible sanctions that they've been under, are not going to give him that gift. Okay, it's just that simple. My colleagues and I are forecasting a softening of attitudes and demands with respect to what kind of expectations Washington will have of its enemies in trying to make a deal with them. And Iran and North Korea, or better known as DPRK, are clear enemies of Washington. So he wants to make a deal. He wants to change the perception. In other words, my colleagues and I think that the Bolton stance, which was an extremist stance in its demands, will probably soften to something more manageable. This is our forecast. And this is they're doing this to send a signal to the Iranian neoliberals in Tehran and those in North Korea who think or foolishly think, both in North Korea and Tehran, is that they could negotiate with Washington, with Mr. Trump. It is absolutely ludicrous for Iranian liberals to assume that. What are you going to negotiate? You can't negotiate over the same real estate twice. You already gave away all your nuclear advancements. They claim it to be peaceful. Washington and our European allies think it's going to be weaponized. It's a military thing. Regardless how you feel, they gave away everything. They gave away 98% of their nuclear stockpile. They shut down their around 20,000 centrifuges, right, enriching uranium to around 5,000. And these 5,000 are older generation of centrifuges. They gave away all their leverage because the Iranian currency went from 1,000 to 3,000 tomans. Well, guess what? It has gone from 3,000 tomans. It went from 3,000 to 20,000 tomans. You do the calculations. That's almost sixfold. And now it's around 12, 13,000 tomans, which is four. It lost, it increased by four times it lost its value, right? You do the math. So if you want to be fearful that your top man, before the coming into power of Trump, or at the time of the negotiation, a year before President Obama left office in 2015, when the nuclear deal was signed, and before that, like I said, the value of the Iranian currency, it lost two-thirds of its currency. Well, guess what happened? You signed the Iranian nuclear deal in 2015, in July of 2015, and what do you have to show for it? Our wonderful liberal colleagues in Tehran, you have nothing to show for it, because your currency went from 3,000 tomans to $1 to almost 20,000 tomans to $1. Okay, a lot of it was economic corruption and these horrible speculators, currency speculators within Iran, who were they're thieves. Let's just call it that. They were stealing from their own people. They were taking advantage of their own people, abusing their own people during a lot of economic uncertainty. But it does have its external foreign element. My point is when Iran negotiated everything, right? They still were under sanctions. And so what did the liberals say? The liberals say that the IRGC is an impediment to true lasting peace between Iran and Washington. This, is, in our opinion, is an oversimplification. If the Iranian nuclear deal was going to be successful, IRGC was still going to be in the arena. IRGC is like a state within a state. They have their hands in politics. They have their hands in foreign policy. They have their hands in internal Iranian economic structure. They own a large consortium of companies that are associated with IRGC. They have their hand in importing products to Iran without tariffs, right? Without any taxes being paid, as is being claimed. I'm not validating those claims, but this is what we're hearing. They are accused of selling Iranian oil off of oil tankers offshore in the middle of the ocean and pocketing the profits. They're accused of a lot of things. The thing is that they're a state within a state. And if the Iranian liberals were that naive to think that they're going to, IRGC was going to give up its power, it's just nothing but the naive way of thinking. And naivete and wishful thinking has no room in the realm of geopolitics, of international relations. Okay? We have to be engaged in, the German term is realpolitik, right? Pragmatism. Practicality, not wishful thinking, not just let's hold hands and sing kumbaya. That has no place in international relations or geopolitics. In international relations, you have the concept of leverage, which leads into countries giving concessions to bigger powers to protect them. You have the concept of national interest. You have the concept of mutual interest, right? These are concepts that are very practical, very calculating, in the realm of political science and international relations. So this was a game. Now, in the back channels, the Iranians, I believe, even the conservatives would possibly be interested in negotiating with Trump administration if they get into power next year. Everything's gonna be on hold, right, for the next year until we find out if Trump gets in or not. And the Europeans are buying time with Iran. They canceled, they reneged a lot of their contracts. I'm talking about European huge multinational, the MNCs, multinational corporations. They canceled a lot of contracts with Iran, multi-billion dollar contracts in the realm of energy and automaking and things like that. And most people don't know that Iran has the 18th largest auto manufacturing production in the world. That's all under sanction by Washington. And all these companies that had signed multi-billion dollar contracts with Iran, one after the other, Total of France, the old, big huge oil consortium, one after the other, they folded. They were just, and their excuse was that we are basically scared of US Treasury Department sanctions. That's it. We're just not gonna sacrifice our economic well-being, our economic survival, because of these multi-billion, tens of billions of dollars of contracts that will be signed with Iran. So they are just buying time. My whole point is that the Europeans are buying time. Okay, they're buying time to see what happens next year whether Trump remains in office, and this is part of a much bigger ideology in the world, whether the national sovereignty people or the nationalists, if you may call it, economic nationalists, the thesis of Stephen Bannon, whether that's going to be the new norm or whether globalism, neoliberal globalism, is going to continue. Germany is a model of neoliberal colonialism, and so are the policies of Emmanuel Macron. Britain is coming out of that model, going back to the national sovereignty model because of Brexit. So there's all these things that are happening in a different layers. So just imagine an onion with different layers, right? So they're waiting to see which thesis wins in the next several years and decades to come. The Russians are going back to national sovereignty model. It's really the neoliberals in China and Europe and United States that are still trying to hang on to the globalism model. China is a huge beneficiary of the globalization model. So they're going to fight tooth and nail to control that, right? Because they're benefiting tremendously, hundreds of billions of dollars as a result of that globalistic model just between them and us, United States. So this is a battle of the will. Let's see who's going to survive. But usually you look at Britain. If Britain wanted to come at a referendum and then wanted to come out of the Brexit, and they have somebody like Mr. Johnson in the premiership or the prime minister of England, then this is a continuation of the Brexit strategies. You have Jeremy Corbyn, who's a pro-Europe person who didn't get enough votes to become the next prime minister of Britain. And there's just so many factors to this. It's a very extremely complex situation, which I hope we managed to just reveal the tip of the iceberg for you guys. I don't believe in simplifying things. There is an acronym people use here, KISS. Keep it simple, stupid, right? My version of that is you keep it simple for the stupid. Our audience, my student, are not stupid people. They're extremely complex and mindful people. So we don't simplify anything. We just shed some light on the extreme complexities of geoeconomic and geopolitical situations. At any rate, I thank you so much if you watch this analysis to its end. It's 45 minutes. We really should have broken it into smaller 10-minute, 8-minute segments. But, you know, I come from academia. We do 3-hour lectures and what have you. And in spite of the ADD and the ADHD, attention deficit hyperactivity disorder, my students are wonderful. They're keen. They're on the edge of their seats when we are having classroom lectures, and they follow through. So we implement that model to our YouTube channel, and hopefully people would, you know, stay tuned and watch these videos to the end and benefit from them. Please feel free to spread these videos on your social media, Google+, Facebook, perhaps creating links on IGTV, Instagram TV, and of course on YouTube. You know, put it on your Twitter feed and what have you. Spread the word. Our analyses are very academic, and they are thorough, and they're extensive, and we've had good feedback from our viewers. Thanks again for your support, and as always, keep the faith alive. Thank you.